I always say that if we wait until we feel great, we're never going to do anything. So we have to keep on doing the best we can, even though we know it's not nearly as good as we would like to do and are capable of doing. This is how it is here, isn't it? And so we cannot be shy about going ahead and continuing to work at it, right? Cannot be shy about that. So just keep on doing it. Just keep on trying. This is the key to success. It's similar to music. There's just certain times where you just can play great. But most of the time, you play a lot less than what you know you can do. You know, you're like, wow, I hope I sound okay, because this isn't really me. This is like I don't know what this is. It's kind of stuck in reverse or something like that. It's frustrating, isn't it? Absolutely it is. But this is what we have on our plate, so we have to plow through it. And so make a little adjustments along the way, which is like what I'm doing right here with this the video. Got a very painful reminder today of how important the times are. I got injured on the job, painful, but because I lost my focus. I started thinking about baseball and following that and stuff, and got injured because I split my attention, and this was the Holy Spirit reminding me, hey, there's going to be a very painful pinch in the world, a crush, and you can't be attached to the world and the storylines of the world at this point. Absolutely must not be attached to the storylines of the world at this point. And I was like, wow, you're really serious about this, huh? Yeah. It's like, oh, wow, okay, I better be serious about it too. And so I'm trying not to backslide into any following any storylines. I was thinking like, oh, maybe I should get into this and follow this and that. And ouch, wow. It's amazing how little things can be so painful. Actually, it was ridiculous, but it was exactly the right angle to get me. It was like the perfect little accident. It's like, holy cow. And so in this reminder, in the world, there's like this perfect storms are possible. They really are, because it's just an expression of our own desire that it be this way. How about that? And so we do provide these very clever excuses for ourselves. The world is just a clever excuse to not pay attention to reality, as we keep pretending that we're somehow separate from reality. We've been working on this project, and we say, God, we're really, you know, really busy on this project. I can't really listen to you right now. We got this really interesting project we're working on. Of course, the project is designed to be separate from God and actually be greater than God. And so we're all caught up in this project. And God knows we're caught up in the project, and God knows what the project's about, and knows that it's just futile. So we think that we need to keep on engaging with this project. And that's what most are doing right now. So the project is about ready to, no question about it, to take a very, let's put it this way, it's designed to knock the wind out of our sails. This is the issue. Okay, now the only remedy is what I call super positivity. Okay, not the normal positivity of conceptual comparisons, but the super positivity of non-dual super positivity. This is actually the only safeguard there is against what is coming in the world. And it's we feel a little awkward doing it. I mean, I was doing it all today, and still a little hesitant, you know, but that comes and goes. You know, you get better at it, then you get a little hesitant, you get better at it, you get a little hesitant. It's like that, because you wonder, How many, who else is doing this? Is this really, should I just ignore what happens in the world? Absolutely. Just stick with the super positive. So we have the capacity here to practice the super positive. It's the positive above all positivity, such as you've heard some of the non-dual positivity. I've never been born. No one's ever been born, actually. No one has ever been born. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing has ever happened, and nothing ever will happen. That's an example of super positivity. Now, today I was practicing part of my all day long. I was practicing, but a part of it was guru power, Longchenpa. Guru power, Longchenpa. Guru empowerment, Longchenpa. Guru empowerment, Longchenpa. So I was just giving all this empowerment to Longchenpa to act here, to free me from this disgraceful, arrogance of existence. And I continue to have a great deal of feedback about the dream of the lady in red. Vajrayogini, very possibly, a heavyweight of heavyweights designed to protect us from death, afterlife, and rebirth. This particular dynamic of grace is very potent in this way, very potent in this way. And it's just like, wow, the potency is just extraordinary of what's going on. Because I asked for it. I asked Longchenpa. I said, do whatever you guys have to do to protect me from any rebirth. And then suddenly this situation has arisen. It's like, wow, great, love it. So super positivity, practicing super positivity is the remedy, will be the remedy. It is the remedy, and it will be essential coming up. It's essential. So I'm trying to get myself fit enough, to do that. And it's not easy. I keep, I'm so tired today. I was so tired. I had to come home, work for 10 and a half hours, and then just had to come home and just sleep. I was just exhausted. But I also did a little bit of workout and tried to keep myself going and didn't skip dinner and just trying to, get in overall good enough shape to participate in a program of super positivity. This is what we are hoping for, that there will be some sort of program, some sort of way where we can really be encouraged to just focus on super positivity. Nothing has ever happened. And there's many ways to express it. Guru power, guru power. Turn to the guru. Seriously. I seriously turn to the gurus. Guru power. This is what the power in the world I want is guru power. Guru power, Longchenpa. Guru power, Longchenpa. Try that chant. Guru power, Longchenpa. Guru power, Longchenpa. Now, I was watching a video about this Tibetan retreat place in New York, and the speaker mentioned how it's important to be able to speak Tibetan, to do the chants and mantras that they do. They have to do it in Tibetan. That's very, very important. Well, I say, okay, I can understand that from one perspective, but I'll tell you what, just say guru power, Longchenpa. Okay, that is a extremely potent mantra right there, and guess what? We're saying it in English. In no way has Longchenpa indicated that we need to learn Tibetan. In absolutely no way has he indicated that. Okay? In fact, I'm getting these very powerful mantras in English. Guru power, Longchenpa. Guru power, Vajrayogini. Guru power, Vajrayogini. Like that, okay. You can do anything. Guru power, Jesus Christ. Guru power, Jesus Christ. Guru power, Jesus Christ. Okay, you can do it. Guru power, Ramana. Guru power, Ramana. Guru power, Ramana. Like that. And This is extraordinarily powerful. The issue is very interesting in that we need confidence on the path. We need to be confident in our path. So these various religions are very confident in their path. We have to have this confidence. We have to believe this is going to work and this is the best for us. So we don't go constantly searching for something else, something else, something else, right? This is a disease. If we always are wandering, say, well, maybe over here, we never get down to practicing. So you have these various approaches that really believe in themselves that this is it. So we have to understand that in the level of confidence, pragmatism, this is great. But we should not confuse confidence with actually reaching the goal. Okay. And so we shouldn't be battling and fighting one another. Recognize, okay, you know, Vajrayana Buddhism, they believe this is it, this is the best. And for them, let it be. That's fine. That's good. Good that they believe in their path. That's terrific. We support that. We support their confidence, just like we support our confidence that this is the best path for us, for instance. It's like that. So be ecumenical. I support all paths, because the confidence that those have in their path. You have to have confidence. You have to believe that what you're doing is the best for you. This is really going to work. Otherwise, you're going to lose your confidence. This is a problem. You have to believe in it. Which is why the Tibetan system with the gurus is so helpful, is they see, you know, the success their guru has had, right? And they say, wow, you know, this is really going to work. This, and the guru says, just do this. And they say, okay, this is it. This is it. Nothing else is it. This is it. Okay, now, being ecumenical, we understand that the uniqueness of our defenses, all defenses are somewhat unique. The habits of attention are somewhat unique, that all paths differ slightly. Okay, so we're not concerned if the Tibetan has said this is it, good, all right. But we also say for us this is it, and we do have the patronage of the Dharma King Longchenpa, helping us out. The one who is the knowledge master of all these paths, especially of Buddhism. But you can believe that he understands everything about it all and is very ecumenical. It hasn't put any pressure on me to try and, you know, convert over to some, you know, Tibetan way of practice or something like that. He's not tried to convert me in the slightest bit. Now, there's some education and awareness and all that kind of stuff, which is fine. I love that. But when it comes right down to it, what did he say? Guru power. Longchenpa, guru empowerment, Longchenpa, all right, Longchenpa, guru empowerment, Longchenpa, guru permission, Longchenpa, guru permission, Longchenpa. In other words, we're saying super positivity, Longchenpa, super positivity, Longchenpa, super positivity, Longchenpa, because this is what he stands for, the great general of skillful means. The great general of skillful means has our back. Okay, and he's not saying you need to go to a Tibetan retreat. He's not saying you shouldn't. But for me, he certainly is not. I don't feel pushed at all in such a way. Not at all. I feel very confident in the path that I'm expressing and sharing here. Very confident. And you know, others might look at it and say, "How? What? I mean, you gotta do the mantras in Tibetan. What are you talking about? or Sanskrit? You know, or you gotta say, and it's got to be, you know, 100,000 times." And I said today, I said guru power Longchenpa. I don't know, maybe 10,000 times. I didn't count. I'm not counting, but I really mean it. You see, it's do you really mean it? Are you really adamant? Are you really fierce about it? You really mean it, and not just outwardly fierce, but you know, just is it just say this is it, you know, right now, guru power, Longchenpa, super positivity, Longchenpa, all right, super positivity, Jesus Christ, super positivity, Jesus Christ, and this is absolutely. You absolutely accept it. You know, you are determined. This is it, and nothing else is it. Super positivity is it and nothing else is it. Non-dual is it and nothing else is it. Truth is it and nothing else is it. Now, this is an absolute fact, but the paths to this nothing else is it, they have this confidence that they're, you know, and they gets a little confused at times thinking that their path is nothing else is it except their path. No, it's the goal that nothing else is it. Non-dual and nothing else is it. It's the goal. But the paths are, every path is unique, actually. Every path is unique. So no one will do exactly what I'm doing, and I won't do exactly what someone else is doing. That's very true. Very true. However, we can absolutely can borrow from other paths and share and pick up pointers, which I absolutely do. I'm not shy at all. If I like something, I'll use it. So if you see something you like, absolutely use it. One of the most useful practices I have is the screensaver with Ram Maharshi, all his quotes on the operating system I have, Windows Vista. You can go in to some folder. I don't know where it is. I can find it, but it's somewhere. I forgot where it is now. Oh well, isn't that how it goes? But you go in and you can select for your screensaver, select a folder of pictures. So I put all these pictures with quotes from Ram Maharshi in this folder, and I select that folder. So when it goes into screensaver mode, you know, it just goes, cycles through all these pictures, fades from one, fade to another, comes up, 10 seconds, fades to another 10 seconds. And so whenever I come home or get up in the morning, first thing I see, I look at my computer, it's open. There's Ram Maharshi with his quotes. It's like, this is what I wake up to. It's like, oh, so awesome. So, oh my God, thank you. So I spend some time, sometimes I just sit there, just watching this screensaver display of all these quotes of Ram Maharshi and pictures. And what a way to start the day. Isn't that better than coffee? It's like spiritual coffee. Wow, spiritual energy drink. I mean, what he says is just so gem-like and exactly to the point. Wow, I'd sure like to have another meeting with Ram Maharshi, I'll tell you that. Guru power Ramana, Guru power Ramana, Guru power Ramana. Wow. You talk about someone who's willing to express the truth. That's it. That's it. You know, it's just right there. What he says is, it's just so flips the script of common belief so much. He doesn't equivocate at all. Does not equivocate at all. That is, it's just spiritual oxygen, really. Just breathe in that spiritual oxygen. All of our great Dharma kings are that way. Spiritual oxygen. I just love Ronald's quotes. They're very simple and to the point. He actually was just had a tremendous teacher and facility, but he didn't speak much or write much, but what he did was, it was just so powerful. He said, speech is always less powerful than silence. There's just a quick one. Speech is always less powerful than silence. Wow. Guru power, Ramana. You see how that works? Guru power, Ramana. Now, I tried to do a slideshow of Sri Sri Nanda Maya Ma last night, and typical of every time I try, the slideshow somehow just disappeared and failed. I was like, what? What happened to it? I don't know, it's just gone. It's just gone, because she doesn't want us slipping into turning to the mother for refuge during crisis, which most people do. When most people are really confused and overwhelmed, like a child. Child tends to get overwhelmed with the world sometimes, right? And what are the first thing to do? Where's mom? Where's mom? Where's mom? And they go running back, you know, and hide behind the skirts of mom. This is just how it works here, how we've imagined this movie script to take place. okay, there's a way that we have imagined all this. We have invented this world. We've imagined all of this. Speaking of that, there's something that may interest you quite a bit. And I try to say stuff that isn't usually said. So to give a wow, like I never thought about that, or wow, that's really, I don't hear that said very often. I was like, whoa, there's a lot of stuff that's true, but we don't say it out of to being polite to others. You know, we're overly polite actually here because we don't want to, you know, wake up. So I talked with this man one time, and I've said this once before, a couple times before, but it's worth repeating. And we were talking about evolution. He said, well, that's not true. And I said, well, what about all the dinosaur bones and stuff? He says, God can imagine a world that with age and create it right now and give the appearance of age and longevity. And I was like, wow, I don't know about that. I've always thought about that. What is that possible? And today I was thinking about it, and I said, you know what? It is possible. This is a real mind bender, to tell you the truth. I was thinking like video games. Can't we make video games that have mountains that are like decaying and crumbling and bones buried everywhere and treasure buried everywhere? In other words, age to it. We make a video game with that? And the video game's right now, right? There's no real age to the video game. But can't we do that like we could make a video game with evidence of you know, sedimentary rocks and all this kind of stuff? Yes, we can. So we give video games with the appearance of longevity and age, historic longevity. Well, why can't our mind do that? So I started thinking about it, really, and considering it. And I realized the mind is capable of doing that. However, it gets quite tricky when you start talking about the cosmos, right? And like supernovas and light reaching us after all this travel. You know, it wouldn't be necessarily easy. I mean, it's very involved. However, if we set about on a project, if spirit set about on a project and really, really worked at it, collectively worked at it, it is possible that we could literally imagine a whole universe of with age and longevity, like billions and billion years old, and we could imagine it right now. Okay? Or, quote unquote, 6,000 years ago. We say God created all the universe in 6,000 years ago. But God didn't really create the universe. We did. We didn't really create it. It's a projection of our imagination. But it is possible that we projected this like a movie with all this age built into it. Already built into it. So as we go about the world, we look at the Grand Canyon. We say, well, it's been there for millions and millions of years, gradually eating it away. However, could we not make a video game with the Grand Canyon in a video game with all the graphics, with the river flowing through it, and if we were looking at a movie of that, and they say, well, this is the Grand Canyon, it's been here for, you know, 2 billion years, this wearing away, this, and we'd say, oh wow, yeah, I can see the evidence of that, I can see the stratification of the rocks, how it's worn away, and yet it's just graphics that we've made. And this is like really, I started thinking about how difficult it would be, but I said, you know, my conclusion was, it's not impossible. It's not impossible for the mind. After experiencing the mind, its creativity firsthand, I realized there's nothing that its creativity cannot display as ornamentation. So what the creationists are saying is not to be absolutely dismissed out of hand, like it's a bunch of knuckleheads, you know, they don't know what they're talking about. They may not explain it very well, but as amazing as it sounds, it is certainly possible. It is certainly possible. It is just like, wow. So all the bones, like all the fossil remains, all that stuff could simply be graphics, like mental graphics there. And all of this is like a three-dimensional holographic, like video game, so to speak, with to convince us in all this historicity of it, that the universe is going on for so long, when in fact it hasn't at all. It's just like a video game, holographic projection. Talk about trying to deceive ourselves. Now, Jesus says we've been working on this project for a long, long time collectively, but he did not necessarily say that it's been, the universe has been going on for all this time. He didn't necessarily say that. And of course, all the ancients say the universe was created very quickly, actually. It came about like poof, 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 like that. It's quite interesting to consider this, isn't it? And that was a big wow for me. I was just saying, well, I can't rule that out, actually. Can't rule out creationism, actually. But what I do say is that God certainly did not do this. God is not trying to deceive itself in the belief in scriptedness. See, we're trying to believe reality can be scripted, so it would make sense that we would try to produce this hologram, this mental projection of our imagination, such that it shows scriptedness has been going on for like 14 billion years or something, right? All throughout this universe of scriptedness. It would make sense that we would do that to try and bolster our belief in scriptedness, but that we might have to work on this and then project it with this illusion of that it's been going on for so long, when in fact it's never been going on, but we're trying to convince ourselves that it has. So we think we're in this universe that's just been here forever. That may not necessarily be true. This is just a mental projection, and we may have just done this mental projection, or we may be doing it right now, you know, each moment, actually. We're capable of doing, our mind is capable of doing this, actually. This is what I've seen. I haven't seen any limitation to what our mind is capable of in terms of projecting ornamentation of spaciousness. There's nothing that says we could not dream up a universe of age and decay and dynamics and all that, and mentally project it, boom, all at once like that, and then have perception as part of that, and then perceive it, and then think, oh, you know, this universe has been here for billions of years. So obviously there's dynamics of change and process, time, space, process, and form. And I spoke before about the dream I had where I woke up, I dozed off and woke up, and I thought I was dreaming of millions of years taking place. And I said, wait a minute, I've only been asleep for just a moment. I just dozed off for a moment, and yet I was feeling millions of years. And that just really, really shook me up. I said, holy cow. Wow. So it is worth bringing this up because it is possible, isn't it? And I know, like, just think, I just like feel, oh, it's a real shocker. But this man I was talking with was like a genius. He was so intelligent. So I listened to what he said. I didn't just dismiss it out of hand. And there are some really bright people that believe in creationism, actually. And it was just not, you know, not to be dismissed just based on what? I mean, because is the mind capable of this or not? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Does that mean that it did this? I can't say it, but it doesn't mean it didn't do it either, right? I'm not saying it didn't do this. It's a very interesting consideration, and keep an open mind about it. We are certainly capable of this. The mind is. And like I said, I experienced this millions of years, like a drama. I saw this drama of millions of years unfolding, and yet it all took place just in an instant. And I was so shocked when I woke up. I said, how's that possible? I was convinced that I was journeying through millions of years. I was convinced of it. It felt like this. And yet I said, how could it take place in just an instant? Just a quick, you know, I don't know how long it was, 30 seconds, a minute, or whatever, but it's a short amount of time. I said, this is just how, I can't explain it. Well, if we could do a million years, how about a billion or billions of years? Yeah, why not? Maybe it's a piece of cake for mine. But Jesus just told us that this universe of time, space, process, and form is just our imagination. And we have, This is a collective effort among many aspects of spirit. And he says that we have worked at it and gone over and over the details to an unbelievable extent to deceive ourselves. It's all an illusion, he says. It's all an illusion, a hallucination. But we have overlearned it, he says, to an enormous extent to deceive ourselves. So this somewhat ties in with what the great non-dualists have said. You know, what they say is it's kind of difficult to fit into our modern understanding of the universe, etc. They say it's all a dream. It's just Maya. It's an illusion. It doesn't exist. So what are you talking about? I said, this universe has existed for, you know, I don't know how many billions of years. And look at all the craters on the moon. But again, in video games, don't we simulate? Couldn't we simulate like meteor hits on a moon, craters on a moon, simulate everything? Maybe this is just a simulation, this entire universe, a simulation in the now. With this basic, it's a game that we set, like a video game, all the parameters are set, all the graphics are already set, and then we play in the game. So you can start a video game, you look at the planets, they got all these, you know, craters everywhere, and whoops, here comes an asteroid making another one. And so we assume that other asteroids have made, you know, all the other ones that are there. But maybe the graphics were just made that way to start with, you see, to make the game seem intriguing for us so we would really get into the game. So maybe all these dynamics, universe dynamics, are just something that part of the basic interface of this game we've made. And then we started playing this game just a short while ago, actually. Now you say, what about the, you know, oil deposits and all that kind of stuff? Well, that too can be put there. Just graphics. It's all just graphics, actually. Now, three-dimensional graphics that we put properties into all these graphics that interact when you know, with all these other problems. So it's a very intricate game we've imagined, set up here. Very intricate basic interface, for sure. But it's not out of the range of possibility. And when Jesus starts talking about what the immense effort we've put into this collectively, then you say, well, you know what? Maybe it is like this, actually. So if we see, suddenly wake up, glimpse it, say, oh, yeah, okay. Okay, so it's like that. All right. But there's something like this, right, that is a stumbling block for us, isn't there? This is what I'm feeling for every one of us. We're almost awake, or we're awake, but we can't quite accept the fact we're awake, because it flies in the face of modern science so much. Now, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, they asked her, what's your take on this world? And she said, well, the whole universe is just like, to me, it's just like this park. The whole area is just this beautiful park. I just wander about in this park. She said, this world has the appearance, everything seems ancient here in this world. That's the appearance that everything has, is it's ancient. But she didn't say that it literally was ancient. See? Are we not capable of imagining all sorts of different degrees of ancientness, maybe? How about that? How about a video game? You know, you go in room A, planet A, and it seems all ancient there, like it's been there for billions of years and all the sediments everywhere. You go to another planet, and it seems like, oh, it was just made yesterday. There's no ancientness to it. This is possible. It really is possible, actually. How do we know how old other planets really are? I know science keeps trying to tell us it's figured everything out. But could we not have devised it all in such a way that Scientists were deceived by it, and so it seems that way to them. Certainly we could. Jesus intimates at this. He says, like, this way he says it, it's like he says, like, this is what you think it is. But he never really agrees with it, like the way we view the world and the universe and all that kind of stuff. He never actually agrees with it. He doesn't directly like attack our position, but he sort of puts in these little sayings of the thoughts that you think you're having, and the way that you think, the universe, the way you think you see it, the way you believe it is, and stuff like that. And I say, hey, wait a minute, he's not exactly agreeing with our take on the universe at all. So we just assume, don't we, that everywhere has the same ancientness as this planet, the same appearance of ancientness, as Sri Chaitanya said. Everything here appears to be so ancient. Everything. That's my how I experience it. That's how it looks to me. I said, that's kind of an odd statement. As opposed to what? Non-ancientness? Well, where is there non-ancientness in the universe, right? You see what I'm getting at? I mean, we say the whole universe is 4 billion years old, so the whole universe is ancient, is it not? To some degree. I mean, stuff closer to the quote unquote Big Bang is more ancient maybe, but really? I mean, if the Big Bang happened all at once, isn't everything sharing in a certain kind of ancientness? Now we know there are new stars, new planets, and things happening like that. This is what we say. But are they appearing in an ancient universe is the question. Are they really so if they're appearing in an ancient universe, aren't they also ancient? I mean the sun and the matter that was expelled by that forming a new planet, if that's what's happening, wasn't that matter there in the Big Bang originally? Or is there new matter being formed everywhere? Right? They can't figure this out exactly, really. I mean, the universe is still a mystery to the scientists. Well, maybe there's a reason for that. Maybe it's not at all what they think it is. Maybe it's an illusion. Maybe it's a deception, a mirage, actually. And again, don't struggle with this. Just wow it, as I say, is a very good term to use. Just wow it. This immediately cuts through. It's like truck choke, cut through. Just wow it. This red helicopter, I suddenly switched my mantra to Vajrayogini. Longchenpa, Vajrayogini, Longchenpa, Guru Power, Vajrayogini, Guru Power, Vajrayogini. And suddenly I heard this helicopter right over flying overhead. And I looked up and it was this bright red helicopter. I said, whoa. Just wowed that. Emergency response. Bright red, lady in red, emergency response. Protecting the Dharma. Protecting truth here in this world, or in our minds, let's put it that way. Jesus says the world's all in our mind. There's nothing outside of our mind. And our mind is right now. So how could the universe actually be ancient, is the question. And he says it's not. Ananda Maima said it appears to be ancient. Has the appearance of everything has the appearance of being ancient. She didn't say it actually was ancient. Has the appearance of being ancient. Pretty interesting, huh? But if you work with modern graphics, I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Digital graphics, the capability. They make all these video games. I've never played video games. I never even looked at them. But could use reason to understand that. You hear people say, well, there's this game set in ancient such and such, and they can make video games set in any time period at all and give this appearance of that you're there in this ancient landscape, and the mountains look like they've been worn down by rivers and rain and all this kind of all the processes of nature, and they make it seem like it's real, like you really have journeyed back into that time. So this is just a minuscule little effort they're doing here. Imagine something, but you know, effort, you know, trillion to the trillionth degree greater than that to come up with some sort of video game, game-like situation, mind game sort of thing. And Jesus actually says that this whole universe, which he says is our effort, is just a, not even just like just a fragment of one drop in an endless ocean of our creativity. He says, as complex as you think the universe is, and as amazing and all this kind of stuff, it's actually just a fragment of a drop in this endless ocean of your creativity. He said, that's all it is. It's no big deal at all. So this is pretty interesting, isn't it? Maybe it's just this game we've been working on. Pretty amazing for us. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? And of course we've plunged into this game with avatars like bodies and playing the game now, and we've tried to forget, you know, all the effort we've made to put into the game, make it seem so real, realistic, at least to us. But it seems realistic to these bodies and sensory perception, doesn't it? But sensory perception, Jesus says, also was simply made to deceive ourselves. He says, don't believe anything that sensory perception is telling you. It simply isn't true at all. So we keep basing our belief in the universe on sensory perception and mechanical, you know, measurements of this light. He says this light is bogus light too. So we keep basing everything on this light and measurements and all this. He says none of that is true. It's all made up. He said the light of the sun is not the true light at all. I mean it's our imagination, the true light presenting our imagination to us. But it's our request that light present ornamentation of itself as completely frozen. But of course, even the ornamentation of frozen light is within perfectly free light, is it not? So you have to go to this degree that even the light we're seeing, that too is a concept. Okay? That too is just a concept. That's part of the game. And just wow that. Just wow it. So I say, okay. Wow. Right? Yeah, that's a wow. And nothing more, do nothing more. That's all. If it's so, then it is so. If it is not, then it is not. I don't need to struggle with it. I just be aware that this is a possibility. And that Jesus is certainly, again, he says, imagine, he said, take the light and then try to freeze it and then freeze it more and freeze it more and freeze it more until it's like totally immobile, basically says. So it's like just absolutely frozen, immobile. He says, this is what your light is like, the sunlight and all this stuff, compared to the true light. And even, you know, it's just, he said, you tried to freeze light to the nth degree in your imagination. But this, like an ice cube of light, let's say, a frozen ice cube of light, this, too, is only ornamentation of its own spaciousness. It's just light presenting ornamentation. Say, okay, I have this ornament that looks like frozen light. But it's still totally within the pure spaciousness of reality, right? It's just ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Which is why, in like Dzogchen, it's about the clear light. They say light is actually totally clear. Now, when we take a prism and sunlight, we see it's all these different frequencies, all these, you know, energy oscillation, frequency oscillations. But real light is absolutely clear. There's no oscillation at all. You put a prism up to it, it's just clear. Pretty interesting, huh? So scientists are saying, well, what do you mean? They take this universe to be real and the light to be real, and this is reality. And so they're measuring what they think is reality. It may not be the case at all. They're just video game avatars doing what video game avatars are programmed to do. Explore this game. Measure the game, explore it in the game. This is all also programmed into the video game figures, like, right? I mean, these figures in video games, I imagine that they're programmed to have certain characteristics and qualities, right? And they react a certain way, they have certain interests and all this stuff. So we make all these virtual reality games right now. Who's to say that this universe isn't just a virtual reality game that we've made? And that these bodies and personalities are just characters, avatar characters that we have all programmed and made to make this game seem interesting to us. Yeah? But they have nothing to do with what we really are. Nothing to do with what we really are. And Jesus says this world, this universe indeed, this light has absolutely nothing to do with what you are, he said. Zero, nada, nothing. Other than the fact that it is an expression of your creativity. But as far as your identity goes, it has nothing to do with your identity. You can gather, he says, you can gather no information or about your identity at all, really. Not really. And he says, granted, because it's your creativity at play and imagination at play, there is the sense of echoes, of tinges of this is, you know, creative and imaginative and all this, yeah. But in terms of your identity, really, he says you really can get nothing from this world. This world has nothing to tell you at all about what you are. Zero. Universe has nothing to tell us about what we are. Nothing whatsoever. So this is not your usual, what you usually hear in this world, is it? This talk, this type of talk. This is super positivity talk, actually. Now, where do you go to get to hear this? This is what I found out in this world. It's like where do I go to hear the truth here? I couldn't find it. There's this sort of cryptic stuff going on. You know, you hear little ancient teachings and of these various religions and some great gurus and teachers. It sounds very cryptic. What are they saying? But where do you go to just hear the simple truth just explained clearly like this? And I couldn't find anywhere. And finally, I came across A Course in Miracles, and I said, wow, this is way better in terms of simple, clear, direct explanation. And then Journey Beyond Words was even better. It's just fabulous. It's just like, wow, yeah, this is what I wanted to find and say. It's kind of hard to say it when you can't find any evidence in this world of it being said, hardly any evidence. You have some teachers saying, like, you know, hey, nothing has ever happened. But they don't really say that much. If you look throughout history, I think it's kept pretty close to their vest, and they pass it on to their disciples. But it's not expressed openly. It has not been expressed openly in the world. And that's what I came to do, just express it openly for everyone in the world. Now, not many pay attention. This is what I found out. It's amazing. Just like I tried to tell people about the tsunami, the Boxing Day tsunami that was coming about a year in advance. I knew all about it. I didn't know exactly where it would be in the world, but I knew there was going to be this undersea earthquake, a 9.1 earthquake, and then this terrible tsunami, which is going to wash through all these different land bays areas. Devastation. I saw the whole, I experienced the entire thing a year before it even happened. And so I tried to tell the world, I put a website, I nobody paid attention. Nobody was interested. I was really shocked by that. I said, oh my gosh, this is amazing. And this is the way it's been my whole life, is I know about stuff in advance, I tell people, they're not interested. Because they're still believing that I'm this person in this game here, virtual reality game, and the person is programmed to act in a certain way and not pay attention to these warnings, or get it wrong, whatever. But Spirit knows what's happening, going to happen. But people go along with the script of this virtual reality game, if it, indeed that's what it is. So it doesn't really do much good to warn anybody about anything. This is what I found out. And speaking the truth, not many listen here. But there are some that do. Because they're waking up saying, hey, wait a minute. Yeah, there's something really screwy about this whole situation here, actually. It doesn't add up. The explanations don't add up. We say, well, what about all the decay, evidence of the decay? Well, can't we make a virtual reality that all the graphics are built in, this all this picture evidence of all this decay, and then have the game start up with actual trees decaying, so that we say, oh, decay has been going on forever. This must be reality, because this is always the way it is. You see how tricky that is? It's like going in reverse. It's like building the whole thing in reverse to get to this point where there's trees dropping leaves. And we say, well, we find evidence that these trees have dropped leaves for a long time. Well, what if we started with the decayed leaves? What if that was the starting point? What if decay was the starting point of our developing this game, virtual reality? And then from there, we worked backwards to trees dropping leaves. And you see that? What if we started with death and then work backwards to the so-called things that are producing this death? And indeed, Jesus said this is a dream of death. So maybe we started with death. You see that? Started with decay. And then worked back to these so-called life forms that supposedly were producing the death. But actually, this was all just a virtual reality that we structured it this way. And they hadn't actually produced anything. We just started out with, okay, like on a drawing board. Okay, well, let's make this decay. Now, where did this decay come from? Well, let's make it decay coming from here. And it goes through these processes, all these processes of decay. And then ultimately, and we built up the whole thing that way. It's very possible, isn't it, if you look at it like that. So the oil deposits came first. And then we say, okay, well, we have to then give evidence of what caused these oil deposits. Okay, let's have all this vegetation then. Also, we come up with all this vegetation that produced all this decay. Right? And we just assume, oh, yeah, the world's millions of years old and all this vegetation caused all this decay. That's not necessarily true. If we have just been dreaming all this up, we may have again started with decay as the primary basis, whole purpose of the game, of to convince ourselves that reality isn't real, that it's all fixed, it's all crystallized. So we think that the life came first and decay came second. How about if decay came first and life came second? Or vegetation, let's say. We think vegetation arose, it all decayed, and had these deposits. What if we dreamed up the deposits first, and then subsequently put all these processes in place so eventually we dreamed up the vegetation? How about that? So we're just assuming that it's a certain linear way like this. Maybe it's the opposite of that. Now, isn't it interesting that this popped into my mind today? Right after the dream of that lady in red, the very possible Vajra Yogini, who some say that she's unequaled in terms of grace. It's just, and I say she, I mean it's an emanation of grace. It's a dynamic of grace. The highest dynamic of grace. That again, she has the capacity to free us from death, to free us from the afterlife, to free us from any reincarnation whatsoever. That this aspect of grace comes into your mind when you're ready to recognize the total delusionary nature of this whole situation, that this perspective I'm having now is arising just subsequent to her, my meeting with her and taking her hand and walking down the steps. You see, I walked up the steps, then walked down the steps. Very interesting. So the steps may be that being shown to me is, what steps do we take as far as this virtual reality goes? How do we really, what do we really start with? And what's the real purpose of it? And maybe she's showing that to me now. That's quite extraordinary, isn't it? And I'm okay with it. And like I said in the dream, I was okay with holding her hand. She was like taking me. Maybe I wasn't walking her down the steps. Maybe she was walking me down the steps, actually. And I was fine with that. Well, it wasn't a problem. So it may have been I was shown being shown the development of this mirage, this virtual reality. And perhaps it did start with decay and deposits, belief in all this stuff, and then we needed, you know, mountains and rivers to so-called cause these deposits. But maybe we started with the deposits. You see this? And if you know digital graphics, you could start with anything, can't you? There's nothing telling you can't start with, like, sand, right? Let's say you start with sand, and you say, okay, I got all the sand. Okay. Now, what do I put in next to so people think that the sand came from somewhere instead of that I just started with that? I want to deceive myself and think that I didn't start with the sand, that it came from something. Oh, well, we'll have rocks. Okay, rocks. But how did it, you know, how did it get from the rocks? Well, we'll have wind and rain that supposedly wore the rocks down and produced the sand, and then rivers bringing it down, you know, and oceans hitting the rocks and causing the sand. So we make oceans and rivers and rain and atmosphere and rocks and stuff. But those are secondary. What if we started with the sand? You see? What if we started with the sand? So I cannot attribute this amazing flipping of the script to anything other than this dream I had with this lady, this in red, this and her and I took her hand, and she took my hand and walked me down the steps. After I had climbed up all these steps, then she walked me down these steps together. We went through them, because the corollary is unmistakable. I mean, I've never thought about this before, actually, ever. Not like this. I had an open mind to maybe there's something that I need to look at as far as evolution, you know. But I didn't really look at it. But now suddenly I'm looking at it, I'm seeing it to in a different way than the creationist put it, right? Very different way. And it's, you know, it's extraordinary. So how am I accessing this perspective? You know, I can't explain it. Never before with any of the teachers I've had has this sort of perspective or ever come up. And now suddenly it has arisen. And it certainly would protect you from reincarnation, afterlife, and death and all this, wouldn't it? And this is said to be her great specialty. It is said that meeting her is the most auspicious. The Vajra Yogini. Vajra Yogini is just the most auspicious grace you can meet up with. That she absolutely will undo your entire, you know, involvement with this. And it's just at this, the way of looking at this, it's possible that this could do the trick, really. Just flip the whole script to totally. By seeing how we've actually scripted all this, and it's backwards, opposite of what we're thinking. And who's to say that our thinking isn't also scripted here as like avatar thinking, like in a video game, that they're programmed to think this way, that this is all ancient, this is how it all happened? Who's to say we aren't programmed to think that way? These bodies, brains, whatever we want to call it, these avatars, these figures, stick figures, as Jesus calls them. Yeah, that might be all programmed into it also, right? And we just assume that what they're saying is true, but I never assumed that. I said, something isn't right here at all. I said, I think we got it all backwards. I think we got everything upside down and backwards. Somebody came up to me a couple days ago. There was this pink Jeep, this big pink Jeep that kids toy they play with. You know, the pink Jeep. I said, ah, that's a girl's Jeep that she loved. And then they tossed it away and they flipped. It was upside down and backwards. It was upside. I said, wow, maybe there's going to be in this world, I don't know exactly what that meant. Maybe it was saying that there's going to be this some female figure, avataric figure, not avataric figure, but grace, you know, some grace is going to come and flip the script, the entire script upside down in terms of how things take place. Or it could be that the yoga girls are coming to flip our wisdom upside down so that we're completely deluded, you know, super deluded. You know, it's one of those like that. That science is going to become the new religion. And science may be totally mistaken, actually. Totally mistaken. All their premises are false. This could very well be the case. And yet, it's going to be mandatory to believe in science. And this may be what this Vajra Yogini is so distraught about. She was crying, just distraught, because she says, this is, you know, she's saying, this is not true. This is, let me show you, this is not true. What science, what they're telling you, simply isn't true at all. And let me show you. Are you willing for me to show you? I said, yeah. Let's walk down these steps together. Let's take a look at these steps together. And she was very pleased, very, very like, yeah. She absolutely was very willing to do this. And I used again the term she, just that's how the dream appeared. But in reality, there's no such thing as gender at all, of course. But being that we still have these issues, that's okay to see. You know, if something appears in a dream as she, then you can talk about it that way without, you know, extrapolating any further than that. Maybe having her appear as a woman like that was very non-threatening. She's kind of this sort of slender lady in red, all red, everything was red. Slender, nice, I mean, it didn't seem very threatening at all. And so maybe she, that sort of appearance is able to go through these steps with us and help us see this without us getting freaked out. I'm not freaked out at all about it. But certainly, if this is so, then this is we're in a super crisis in the world in terms of our wisdom. It's a wisdom crisis. And she's like the ultimate wisdom Dakini, like Vajra Yogini, the ultimate wisdom Dakini, to tell us what the ultimate truth really is. And she knows this is a crisis, very much so, where the wisdom of religion, which is certainly has been teaching something very different than what science believes throughout history. There's no question about it. And they kept it close to the vest. But we may now be seeing what they're really talking about. As Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodro said, anything that comes and goes is nothing but illusion. Well, isn't he not talking about the Grand Canyon and the sedimentation? Isn't that all coming and going? Yeah, exactly what he was talking about. He said, it's just illusion. It's all illusion. An illusion. What does he mean, illusion? See, this is the question. Well, we now know about virtual reality and video games and all this kind of stuff. Maybe he's, you know, sort of alluding to that as a mental illusion. This is what the teachers say. It's just a mental fabrication, an illusion. It doesn't really exist at all. And now, maybe now we're getting a sense of this, aren't we? Sort of dotting the I's and crossing the T's to this. Maybe, you know, the Tibetan Tibetan gurus or I don't know whatever. Maybe they think, what, you know, how's this guy? How can Vajrayogini appear to this guy? You know, he's some Westerner, Caucasian Westerner living in California. That's crazy. I mean, well, didn't Ramana Maharshi say that all that's required is steady perseverance, and that nobody succeeds without this great determined perseverance, but all those who succeed owe their success to this perseverance? And he said, I anyone, anywhere can succeed as long as they have this quality. He didn't put any restrictions on it. Ramana put no restrictions at all. And he said, the enlightenment I have is going to be exactly the same enlightenment that you have and that you have, or anyone from any in the world, anywhere in the world has, no matter what their race or background. It's the same enlightenment. Count on it, he says. So I'm just somebody who has great determined perseverance, that's all. And that's all you need. It's not about being born in Tibet or born somewhere, somewhere in the world. It's about your steady, determined perseverance. That's what it's all about. And I've certainly done that. So it's not any surprise that Vajrayogini would appear to me like this and take my hand and show me what's going on. Because she knew that I could handle it. That's all. And it doesn't bother me at all, actually, what I'm saying. I mean, there's a wow to it, but yes, it's a wow, but I'm not, bothered by it. Just take it in stride. Take it in stride. I love it. I love it. I love this kind of talk. I just eat it up. So thank you. It's great. More. I like what's on my plate. I'm cleaning the plate up, licking the platter clean and say, second helping, third, come on, give me some more of this. I love it. So I'm not choking on it or having indigestion or anything. It's great. This is what I live for. This is wonderful. But conventional gradualists might be scratching their head and say, what? And what they do, they just ignore it, right? They just ignore it because deep down they can't really dismiss it. So they just ignore it. So generally, I've been ignored in my life by conventional religionists because I was on such a fast track, and I didn't, as a maverick kind of, because I didn't want to get pulled into this gradualism. I said, I got to reach this goal. I got to really, get there, and this is too slow. So they just basically have ignored me. But that's their deal. It's not mine. I cannot be held account for them ignoring me. That doesn't mean that I don't haven't done what I've done. I have. They just ignored it. That's their problem. It's not my. I'm not going to make it my problem. If Longchenpa showed up to help me out, then Vajrayogini can show up to help me out, plain and simple. Is this Vajrayogini the same in Christianity, what you call the Virgin Mary? Well, that's possible, but it's also possible that a lot of terrible idols have been made out of this. Okay. Certainly, it's not the same Virgin Mary that the Spanish, rode the conquest, rode under that banner and all this kind of stuff. And many, many, many foolish idols have been made of the quote-unquote Virgin Mary. But maybe the Virgin Mary is just this archetype, the spiritual archetype of Vajrayogini, right? This sort of archetype that enables us to see that none of this is true. Even, it's completely opposite of what we thought it was. I mean, that's possible, right? I got an open mind to that. Whoops, what happened here? It just stopped. Is it still going? Yeah, it's still going. Just, yeah. I mean, this is, see, I understand that we make fear distorts truth and makes all these terrible idols out of it. Okay. So there may be some that have gotten this help from this from grace that they the fem feminine figure, right? And they'd say, "Oh, that's the Virgin Mary, the mother of God, or mother of Jesus, or you know, the whatever you want to put it, however you want to put it." I have no problem with that. That's wonderful if that's the case, and maybe it has been like that. But also, there's just you know, a lot of ridiculousness around the Virgin Mary, actually. Too, okay, so that's also present. I'm aware of that too. And this is what happens in this world, is our programming causes us to distort and get all confused about truth. So like I said, this feminine figure did appear in my dream and took my hand. I thought I was taking her hand, maybe she took my hand. I was willing to put my hand out, I was willing to take her hand. And then this clarification has come, which is just, you know, mind-boggling almost, isn't it? Just amazing stuff. And maybe it's not the mother of God, but the mother that leads us to God, that mothers us towards God. You see that? God doesn't have a mother, but how about our mother who helps us help get comfortable and familiar with the true God? You see that? In other words, it's the mother that we run towards. Like when we're scared, we're overwhelmed by the craziness of this world, we run to this mother who tells us the truth about what this world really is. Like that. And then this helps us realize, oh, the Father really is, you know, all there is, really. This mother is an aspect of grace. It's not really the Father. It's not the prime. It's an aspect of grace. But it again, like when you're a child and the world seems really weird, overwhelming, you run to mother and she seems so familiar and wonderful to you. So maybe this great archetype of grace is a way for us to run away from the weirdness of this virtual reality back to reality, and she helps us feel familiar with it, something like that. It's possible, right? Absolutely it's possible. This figure didn't really act like a mother. We walked on the steps equally together. But I can tell you, walking the steps, she was very poised and graceful. No stumbling, no awkwardness, no uneasiness, nothing like that. Ramana said, "Don't worry about finding the guru. Just apply yourself to the information you have as best as you possibly can and keep on working with the knowledge that you have." He says, "The guru is searching for you and will absolutely find you. They know the ones who are prepared, who have worked diligently for the next clarification. They will find you." So maybe I've been found by Vajrayogini. And it's part of the madness of these avatars. Maybe that's not a good term. These video game characters, these virtual reality characters that we think we are, that they're all patriotic and they mix religion with politics and stuff, and they want to think that their religion is the greatest because their country is the greatest, and you know, and all that stuff gets all junky and garbage, right? And they become very defensive. You know, you can't use that term or whatever like that. But really, I've never had anybody be that way with me. I mean, the potential is there, I understand that. But nobody's ever gotten upset with me, really. So you can't use the term long jump, that's a, you know, Tibetan. It's like, no, nobody said that. Krishnamurti used to decry this, you know, the mixture of politics and religion and jingoism, religious jingoism and all this stuff. It's terrible. He says it's a scourge of the world. But that may be what these virtual reality characters are programmed to do, right? Yeah. Get it all confused. be confused, remain confused. So this is an extraordinary development here, just before May 27th, which I said is one of these key dates that we want to have some sort of readiness that, you know, and this is just like an extraordinary breakthrough tonight. That may very well key our readiness. Readiness. Lady in red, getting us ready. Getting us, she was totally red, getting us totally ready. All thanks to this lady in red. What a great grace it has turned out to be. If this is indeed the case, because flipping the script that we've done like done here tonight, this really is something that is powerful enough to carry the battle, isn't it? Carry the day. And no matter how weird the world seems to get, if we can work on this perspective like this, wow, that just it's just a knockout blow, actually, for the world. It's just a knockout blow. Hey, I got my swim trunks today. How about that? I got my pool attire now. Got my white slippers, rubber slippers. I've got my black and white swim trunks. So I'm ready to go poolside now. It looks a little odd. It's different. Yeah, it's like I'm not used to it, but I'll get used to it. So I'm ready to hang out at the pool right now. We're ready to hang out at the pool and talk about how I am 360-degree pristine unbelievability. And isn't this unbelievable, the ability to go beyond all belief, the way what we've been talking about here tonight in this video, that maybe everything in the sand came first? I mean, how about that? I mean, most people say that's absolutely unbelievable, isn't it? Well, we have the ability to see the unbelievable, don't we? Yes, we certainly do. And we certainly have that here now, thanks to the grace of God, which is the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of total wholeness, of total truth, and then the emanations of this Holy Spirit, the various archetypes that how it emanates and work helps us out, which you might call Sambhogakaya, the bliss, various bliss bodies, and then the various Nirmanakaya, the various incarnations such as Sri Sri Nandamayama, Ramaharshi, Longchampa, Jesus Christ, those various actual Nirmanakaya bodies that actually come into the world appear here. These are all aspects of the Holy Spirit. Avalokiteshvara, they might say in Buddhism, the one who is constantly watching everything, right? Holy Spirit, the grace of God, the dove on high that sees everything. It's aware of everything that takes place. So all thanks to the grace of God for this. And all thanks to the viewers here who have helped all of this, help birth all of this, you know, with your viewing and your comments. Steady viewership. Not large in numbers, but enough to keep me motivated. And you know, I said, I'll get this in time, I'll get this, I'll succeed. I'm always on time. This is a very interesting characteristic I have that I cannot explain. If somebody says, meet me here at 7:30, I walk in the door. I say, I wonder what time it is. I say, you know what, I bet you it's 7:30. I look at my watch. It turns out I walked in the door like exactly 7:30, 00 seconds, you know, that kind of thing. It's without even trying. I say, well, I better leave now, you know, make sure I'm not late. And it's just like, I'm always on time. It's just really weird. And so I feel like I'm going to get it, you know, whatever it is I need to do or to be, or I'm gonna do it in time. In terms of, I won't be late. What's today? Is it what, the 16th or something? Or is it 15th? I don't know. What is the. It's the 16th. Interesting, the 16th. I knew I had to get it by late May. I knew I had to get it, sometime in May. Well, this is the second half of May, isn't it? So the second half of May, 16th, boom. There it is. And there may be some practical stuff I need to do now also. Where's that swimming? Where's that pool we're going to hang out at? Pool party. Where's the pool party? I am that pristine unbelievability. Believe it. Feel it. Yeah. So there may be some pragmatic stuff I need to do. I need this injury to heal up quickly. This is really like telling me, no, don't get back into the world. Don't let anything sucker you back into that. I said, okay, yeah. I had an intriguing storyline I could have jumped on, and my mind was starting to do that. So I got a bite. The Holy Spirit really bit me with that one. It says, you wanna fail? You wanna get crushed? You wanna get put in a really severe pinch? Well, that'll take you there. So don't do that. Okay, man, but just all right, but heal it up quick, this wasn't fun. That's for sure. A really weird one. I didn't say anything, but I was hurting, I tell you. It wasn't as bad as the last one, a brick falling on my thumbnail. That was even worse. And the funny thing is, it's just like, this thing just like kind of just tumbled. Just, it shouldn't have hurt, it shouldn't have done anything, but it just precisely the angle of everything. It's just like bizarre. It's like, wow. Any other angle wouldn't have done anything. Takes good timing, right? And what about all these petrified trees with, insects in them and radio dating and all this kind of stuff? Could that also have been set up as part of the original basic interface? Of course it could. I mean, could we not lace the entire interface with massive amounts of plausible evidence for ancientness? Couldn't that not be something that we worked on assiduously to an extreme extent, as Jesus puts it, so that we constantly, and then have scientists constantly finding evidence for ancientness, and yet we lace the whole thing with all of that, like termas, like buried treasure there for scientists to find and proclaim, aha, more proof of ancientness, more proof of evolution, right? Could we not have done that? Absolutely, we could have done that. Maybe we just dreamed up in our imagination, just, endless, little insect. Let's have all this evidence of ancientness by putting these skeletons of insects and start out with the skeletons and start out buried, embedded in all this rock and ossified trees falling into this, all this stuff, and then work back from that to the insects, you see? We certainly could have done that. You might say, well, yeah, we could do it, but why would we? Well, to deceive ourselves, of course. And that's what Jesus says. This whole illusion is designed to deceive ourselves, to make it seem like reality isn't real. That we think this is reality. Look all over it. And to preoccupy ourselves with examining all this evidence, which is fake evidence. Jesus said it's fake evidence, actually. He said that all this evidence is fake. Or he said something to that effect. It's all fake. It's all fake. This whole thing is fake. This whole universe is fake, actually. And Jesus says, when you wake up and you see it, it's all just been a hallucination, you laugh and say, look at all the work we put in to make this fake. Of course it's fake. And eventually he says, you'll see this, and you'll just have a laugh at it. He says, that's all. One pool party coming up here, folks. Yeah. I did some work, a workout today. It was pretty strenuous. I turned my legs to jelly. I was a jellyfish. Jelly. But at least I did it. And I have some fitness. I have some fitness right now, actually. Some degree of fitness. I guess you could say, have some degree of fitness. Now, I would say it's low degree, but you wouldn't say I'm unfit. Far as either are you fit or unfit, you'd say I'm fit, and I might say, well, I have kind of a low degree of fitness, but at least I could say I'm fit. I did this workout that's quite difficult, really. It just gassed me. I'm telling you, my legs turned into jelly. Absolutely into jelly. Wow. But I recovered and I'm okay. But was able to do it. Pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. Holy cow, just to think that I could do it. Just have the confidence. I think I can do this. Gee, before, there's like no way in the world. I would say, oh yeah, I can do this. I would have said, are you kidding me? But now I had the confidence, said, you know what? I think I can do this. Well, it wasn't easy, that is for sure. But I did it. So that indicates, this is like a good fitness thing, like a test. Yeah. Do you have the confidence and can you do it? Yeah, even if I've totally gassed, I still did it. And that's what they're looking for. Like the Marines, you go through boot camp, they're looking for a certain level of fitness. Where can you get through the obstacle course? Well, if you make it, you make it. You may stagger across the finish line and just be absolutely gassed and you're a jellyfish. You may not just strut across it, the line, finish line, but the Marines will say, okay, you've got a base level of fitness now that we can work with that. We can work with that. Okay. Now you can go on to, greater training. It's more specialized training because you have this basic level of fitness. You don't have to just be first in your class with fitness. You just have this base level. And maybe there's some super athletes that just saunter across the finish line and say, ah, it was easy. What's next? Okay. I mean, they're super fit, super fit. But you can say, well, yeah, you're super fit, but I'm fit. I have base fitness. I have enough base fitness to go on to the next situation, whatever it may be. So I have that now. I have base fitness, you could say. Pretty interesting that base fitness and this flipping the script came on the same day, right after the day after Pentecost, and this dream took place on Pentecost of this Vajrayogini dream. Took place on Pentecost, which is in Christianity the descent of the Holy Spirit, the grace of the Holy Spirit, as a what a red flame. Pretty amazing, huh? A red flame, as dream of this red lady, red woman, all in red like a flame, you could say. Yeah, very similar to Pentecost, actually. And maybe the Spirit of Truth descended upon me in Pentecost of 2:16. That is possible, because now I have this possible perspective change, flipping of the script, and it's quite extraordinary. Just to be able to think it through like this without being bothered by it at all, I don't have any trouble doing this. And I say, huh, okay. So he started with sand. How interesting. And it seems to feel like maybe this is right also. It's like, yeah, if we really wanted to deceive ourselves, wouldn't that be how we went about it? Yes, it would be. Yes, it would be that we would go about it in what we look would seem to be a backwards way. Now we think, no, that's not how it happened. But maybe that is exactly how we went about it. Maybe we started with the effects that we wanted to deceive ourselves with, and we started with the byproduct of all these effects of quote unquote nature, and then we started backfilling then all these effects of nature, so eventually we came up with quote unquote nature, but we started with the effect. The end game was all the effect of process. See, we started with the end result of process. That's what we started with, and then backfilled all these so-called dynamics. We didn't start with the dynamics and end up with the effects of the dynamics. We started with the effects we wanted to have, and then imagined the effects that so-called caused this. You see what I'm saying here? Maybe that's the way we actually imagined all this. So that's why religious people throughout history have insisted on creationism, that that's the real truth. So to speak, I mean, they have some distortions of it. They don't quite understand what they keep thinking, that God did this and that we are real human. We are human bodies, and God put us here to enjoy this and blah, blah, blah. They miss the whole idea of these virtual reality figures, like in games, that, you know, the gamers make all these figures that you can identify with or make the game seem interesting to you. They have nothing to do with what you really are at all. And the body has nothing to do with what we are. That's what Jesus says. Nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. So why are they here then? They're just figures in a virtual reality game, huh? Seems that way. This is a very good theory, you might say. Actually, it's sort of like out of the box. It's a theory. It's not even a hypothesis. It's a theory here. It's a theory. This is a really extraordinary theory. Maybe this was a flame that I met, but to make it less seem less frightening, it had this appearance of a nice lady, a very gracious type of lady, that you would act, you know, in a gentlemanly way towards, that kind of thing. Lady full of gracefulness and grace, although she was distraught initially. I think that was to get my attention, and so I would take her hand, and maybe that distraughtness was pointing out that, hey, we need to take a look at this world. Let's go down step by step to reach the world. Maybe that was me. Let's see all the steps we took to get to this notion of the world that we think is the way that it is. So she wanted to take me down those steps because she realized that you know, awareness of truth in this world is very threatened now, because the scientific paradigm is looking to crush religion, and it is. Make no mistake about it. This is how this virtual reality game is working out. It wants to crush religion, which religion has this answer of knowing that it's fake. Okay, at the very root and heart of religion is this knowledge. It's all fake. This is what the great teacher told us. It's all fake. That's what Jesus tells us. It's not real. It's all an illusion. They want to crush that. That's part of the game, is making sure we root out any awareness of truth, that this is just a game. And so Spirit keeps identifying, oh, these figures are what's real. This game's real. So there's this part of this game which is designed to just crush awareness of this, of truth. And this is what we're coming up upon. Indeed, Jesus said that this end of this age, quote-unquote, the deception and the lies of the devil, the ego, the Satan, is going to be so bad that even the saints are in danger of losing their wisdom. It's the worst ever. And we're right there, right now. This is it. So it's an extreme emergency right now, spiritual emergency. You get someone like Longchamp showing up, this is an attention getter. I mean, this is an acknowledged, you know, great, great spiritual general, so to speak. This is in Buddhism, they universally acknowledge that this is, you know, one of, if not the top heavyweight, you know, right there at the very top echelon of heavyweights. And if he shows up in response to the prayer I gave, You got to believe that he thinks there's something very serious going on here. That he knows. Sorry, I said think. He knows there's something very serious going on here. And he's just waiting, you know, for whoever, you know, to show up and help whoever, you know, says, help. I believe there's something profoundly, some profound trouble here. And we really need the most help we can possibly get. That's what my prayer was. We need all the help we can get, the most profound help we can get. We really need it now. And then, boom, he shows up. So obviously, he knows all about it. And Jesus showing up with the Course in Miracles, of course Jesus knows all about it, giving us this heads up. And he always says to me, go urgent, just like extreme urgency, go faster. He says, you really got to go as fast as you can. Don't walk up the steps, run up the steps. And when you get tired, then walk, but then as soon as you can, start running again. So always this tremendous urgency. You get someone like Sri Sri Anandamayi showing up in the world, this indicates some tremendous crisis is coming here. I mean, this is just, you can't get any more heavyweight than her. You just cannot. And so this shows up in the world. This means all measures are being taken. There's some extraordinary issue, crisis coming upon us. It's not business as usual. And Ramana too, same. I mean, you talk about a heavyweight. You talk about a heavyweight. So they're all coming and coalescing at this time. So you got to understand there's just tremendous crisis coming. And so, but along with that, we have this tremendous preparation. Right? So I'm like, hey, yeah, let's hang out at a pool. No worries. Got it covered. These gurus have it covered. Absolutely have it covered. No worries. They will not fail. Failure is impossible for them, actually. There's no such thing as failure to them. We just have to accept that. Right? And we're flipping the script to, and thanks to all those that are helping out. You're doing a great job, say the least. We have some heavyweights here, actually. We really do. It's pretty amazing. Some of the contributions are from heavyweight. I mean, not the heavyweights like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, but I mean really great non-dualists who really, really are waking up and really get it. You know, that's a tremendous indication here. This is not just your ordinary people who go to, you know, the teacher or teaching or something, and they ask questions. No. This is those who are right there, you know, and get it. That's very, very good. It's great. It's not always quantity, it's quality. How many apostles were the Jesus started with? 12, right? It's the quality, not the quantity. It's the quality, not the quantity. So, how many? I mean, there's a number here. The number of them here, I don't know. 5, 6, 7. I mean, there's been quite 8, maybe 10. I mean, maybe there has been altogether maybe 12 here. That really get it. Maybe more. That aren't, you know, bothered by flipping the script, and that really know what it's all about. They're just emerging. Is it okay to say this? You know, is it okay? So, you know, like that sort of thing. So I try to break the ice and say this stuff. This is sort of my role. is always willing to say what other people aren't willing to say. And people say, "You can't say that. Don't say that." The other, all these people, adults, are saying, "What a mouth he has." They'd say, "I apologize for it, but you know, and I'd be in social setting and just speak the truth." And people, "Oh, you can't, what are you talking about?" I mean, and they'd say, "Oh, he's got a great imagination, you know, just don't worry." But they're kind of like, we don't really want him around socially because this makes everybody uneasy. So it wasn't that I was antisocial at all, is that people didn't want me around socially because I'd speak up like this. This is really the case. So I got this complex thinking I'm antisocial. What's wrong with me? No, that's not true. It's not true. I can function perfectly well, but people don't want me around. That's the fact. Because you start talking like this, and because people get very uncomfortable, they say, it's like, because they say, "Wait a minute, but I thought I was this human being. I thought this was me, and then you're telling me just of this virtual reality. There's no, that's not me. Well, what? You know, what's going to happen to the human being then?" You know, it freaks them out. It freaks them out. And you probably know what I'm speaking of. If you really start speaking the truth to people, they just kind of go, maybe you should like go over there somewhere, and you know, maybe this isn't your crowd, you know." So I did rest for a while this afternoon, and that helped me. Wow, I almost had to drink coffee. Thank God I did not. Or a coffee drink. I was so tired, almost falling asleep driving home today. It was just brutal. And so what I did was, I got this go ahead. It's like, it's okay. I said, okay. So what I did, I put my hand on the bottle of was a mocha frappuccino or something like a bottle of Starbucks thing. So I had my hand on the bottle of this coffee drink, and immediately I felt like better. Just because my mind, just the contact with that bottle was enough to give me like a jolt of confidence, or that I wasn't going to fall asleep. And so I just kept my hand on this bottle as I was driving for a while, and this kind of woke me up. And then I started to realize, oh, I'm close enough to home where I think I can make it. And then I made it that way. So I didn't actually open the bottle or drink it. I just had it in my hand. My hand was touching it. I said, isn't that interesting? What a wonderful placebo effect that was, huh? Just as like a reassurance that, you know, that I'm in touch with it. So sometimes just being in touch with something is enough. That's what I found out. I didn't actually have to drink the coffee. Maybe you should try that next time you're tired, you know, just have the steaming cup of coffee, whatever you have, whatever, and just you say, you know what, just having it here, just carry it with you, but don't actually drink it. And you may find that you get a contact high with it without any of the adverse effects, and then I could go home and I could sleep. So I got the best of both worlds. I got a contact high, and then I could actually rest, and no hangover, no terrible caffeine after effects. How are we doing here? Wow, we're doing pretty well. The computer is working, although I do have one problem, is I can't delete anything from this memory chip. Very odd. I don't know what to make of that. I keep trying to delete the files in the trash bin. It says they're all gone. I open up again, they're all still there. But other than that, everything is functioning. I had this virus hit my computer, and I asked Longeveta to smooth it out, and suddenly it was all smooth, all smooth. I don't have any virus program or anything, so I didn't run anything. I didn't do anything. It just smoothed out. I thought my computer might be toast. It's happened to me before. Completely ruined my computer. Lost everything on it. irrecoverable, could not. So I thought, uh-oh, I'm in trouble. This is bad, really bad, because I need to get this information out here. And Longchenpa, I prayed to him, says, Longchenpa, this is important, you know, let's fix whatever, smooth out this computer and make it keep working. And this is what has happened. But I also need these files deleted, too. So other than that, I'll have to keep buying memory chips, which maybe he wants me to do. I don't know. It gets expensive. Maybe I'll put it in a different computer and delete it that way. I can try that, can't I? Yeah, that's a way around it. Some heat is coming here, the Bay Area. Supposed to pop up tomorrow and then really strike strong Wednesday. And then go back to cloudy coolness, like low 70s for the next, you know, week or so. So, yeah, it's very pleasant here. Extremely pleasant, you might say. Ridiculously pleasant. It's been a help living in this area with basically, you could say, some of the best weather in the world. I mean, Santa Barbara is very nice, and but this area here is just as good as any as far as weather in the world, no question about it. California is just amazing, and certain areas are just extraordinary. And it's given me this feeling of, there is, you know, maybe there is something really, really, really wonderful for us that it's a grace, you know, a grace of God. Because the weather here seems to be like a grace of God. It really does. It feels that way. It feels so friendly and kindly, you know, the weather here. It really does. It's just, you feel like you're loved, you know, something loves you. The atmosphere loves you, which is, it helps. It helps. It's not harsh. It's not trying to destroy you. It seems like it's like supportive of you. So I always love the atmosphere. I thank it. You know, I thank it here. Those of you who live in California Bay Area know what I'm talking about. Is we fall in love with the weather, the atmosphere, and we really do love it. There's no question. It's like a love affair with the weather here. You just get up in the morning, you just look, you go outside, and you just shake your head and just say, wow, another awesome day weather-wise. You just can't beat it. It's so kind and gentle and wonderful. That's why people like to be outdoors, out in it. I had to lock myself in a room for 15 years, and it was pretty tough. It was terrible, but I had to do it to get on track. But I did it. Didn't like doing it. Because you really want to be outside here. That's why people have so many convertibles. I used to have a convertible. Wow, don't now. I'd certainly like to have another one. Just driving around in this atmosphere and air. It's just love it. I mean, there's nothing better than just cruising here. Just driving in your car. I mean, it's just fabulous. If you have a convertible. And looking at all the beautiful landscaping and the atmosphere here. It's just, if it's hot, you have the air conditioning on. But with the top's down and the convertible, you have the air conditioning hit you. The warmth of the sun is hitting you. It mixes together. And you just feel like maybe there is perfection somewhere. So it kind of has this hint of perfection to it that gets you thinking, like, you know, how come everywhere can't be like this? And how come, and like, when the weather is not so great, which is very rare, I always get very upset. Like, what? What is this? This is not right. It's not fair. Every day should be perfect. So you get this feeling you want perfection here in California. You really want perfection. And so you dig for it. This is what I found. It sort of gets into you, this desire for perfection. And you don't settle for anything less. Now, here's something very interesting that I just remembered. It's kind of like I've been auditing this whole world, or this game, virtual reality game, for the religions, teachings, and belief systems. What's wrong? And, you know, I was at this place today, and there's this guy helping me. He's an elder person, kind of like myself. I know, maybe I don't look so elderly, but I'm in my 60th year now. If you start 0 to 1, that's your first year. Well, 59 to 60 is your 60th year, actually. When you reach 60, that means you've completed 60 years here. Actually, that's what it actually means. You've completed 60 years. So I'm in my 60th year to be completed this summer. So you could say, well, you hit 60, you know, you're kind of among the elderly, I guess, now. So he was probably around my age or so, and he had a lot of deformities and troubles, and you could tell he's led a really rough life, but he was hanging in there. I mean, he's a real blue-collar worker guy, and it was just and I said, hey, you know, another Monday, huh? And he said, yeah. And I said, hey, it's not easy, is it? And he says, wow, no, not at all, not at all. And I say, you know, it's just, sometimes it's not easy to get through it. You know, the work week started as another work week. It's like, wow. He said, yeah, I know. And we both know exactly what we're talking about. And he says, but, and I said, well, sometimes I wonder, how do we get through it? He says, well, simply, he says, we don't have any choice. We don't have any choice. And that was his life philosophy. You just simply have no choice. And then I remember the guy I met in this really, really terrible place. It's just the worst place you want to work with, and there that could almost possibly be. One of these jobs where the absolute bottom of the barrel. And his philosophy says, I remember I told you in the video, he says, I feel happiest when I just accept everything just the way it is, and there's nothing I can do about it at all. And I thought that was profound, but then I said, wait a minute. And suddenly it flashed upon me, this whole script just flipped on me, and I realized that the way that most people in the world maintain any sort of sanity at all is just to believe they have no choice whatsoever. This is the religion of the world. It's just we don't have any choice. And I realized this is what I've come across throughout my life. This is the basic philosophy of most people in this world. The only way they can stay so-called happy is to say, well, I don't have any choice. This is just my lot in life. There's nothing I can do about it. And this gives them at least a little bit of solace. Because if you say, oh, no, you've got a choice, then it's like hell for them. Right? They say, oh my gosh, you mean I have a choice, but they can't relate to this. They cannot relate. And this is why they have a problem with me, is because I always say, what are you talking about? I don't have any choice. Of course you have a choice. You're choosing this. Then they think, oh my God, I'm choosing this? That means they can't relate to this at all. And it makes them feel very unhappy. But if they think, well, just I have no choice at all, so why even worry about it? Then at least they don't worry about, why did I choose this? You know, I put myself here. This is me doing this. I chose this. Oh, that's horrible. You know, they don't want to think that way. And then they realize, oh, I got to put all this effort into making a different choice. And they say, well, this effort would make me very unhappy. Whereas you just say, I have no choice. Then you just be lazy and say, well, at least I don't have to put any effort into changing my situation. I just don't have any choice. And a lot of people recently, there's people like hauling dirt. All they do all day long is put dirt into a wheelbarrow and haul it into it. You know, and I said, wow, it's a tough job. And they shrug and say, yeah, but I don't have any choice. So every time I run into people doing really tough work, they always say, well, I don't have any choice. And this is how mentally they deal with this really brutal work. I mean, how would you like to be shoveling heavy dirt into a wheelbarrow and then wheeling it and putting it in a dumpster all day long? Yeah, that's what people do. I go shake their hand. How are you? Talking a little bit. But this is what they do. I'm around these people all the time. It's the bottom of the barrel jobs. And their philosophy is, I have no choice. Don't have any choice whatsoever. Just shrug it off. But you see, the idea of having to do this work, plus thinking that you chose to do this and therefore you have to figure out how to choose something else, just seems too daunting for them. And they think it would ruin their life completely to even think that way. So they refuse to think that way. And so this is why it's so difficult to teach the truth here in this world, is people just, they just think it would make them so unhappy. And to some extent, they're right about that. Accepting your lot in life seems to be the only solace we have about this whole situation. But for me, I never accepted my lot in life at all. I said, absolutely. I said, my lot in life is perfection. Anything other than that, I'm choosing to experience something. It's my choice, and it's my problem. And I have no choice but to go back and choose perfection. So then life has been a struggle for me because I keep choosing something other than perfection. And I know it's me that's choosing it. So I have to figure out, I have to stop choosing it and go back to choosing perfection. So it requires enormous dedication and determination, which is very tough. It's been a super tough life. So I'll tell you what, it's a lot easier to load dirt and just your whole life, you know, load dirt in a wheelbarrow and just assume like I got no choice than it is to try and choose perfection. But the problem is they'll keep loading dirt in a wheelbarrow. Or, you know, they'll keep until they choose something different. And, you know, you'll keep getting these menial jobs. You'll keep getting these maintenance jobs. This is tough stuff. And you'll keep being enslaved to those who cleverly manipulate the idea they have no choice but to enslave you. You see? They can't have perfection either. They're stuck. They say, God knows, I'm stuck here too, so I want to be comfortable, so I might as well enslave people to do all this heavy, terrible work for me. They're stuck. They feel they're stuck in that too. And that's no fun either. So you have to have a life where you decide, no, perfection is my inheritance. I will settle for nothing less than perfection. And anything less than that, I'm choosing to deceive myself. Period. That's all there is to it. And I have to crack the nut of this self-deception. And that becomes a very strenuous life. And my life has been very stressful and strenuous. Just extremely so. But it's also been very, very amazing and interesting, astonishing, and ultimately fruitful, I would say, is going to be ultimately fruitful. And will result in experiencing perfection. Most certainly it will. Anything less than perfection would be uncivilized. Of course, but of course. Excuse me, do you have any perfection? But of course. The window goes back up. Anything less would be been civilized, dear chap. Don't you think so?
Right, but that's really what it was like.
You don't say. You don't say, Governor.
Yeah, I do say. We do
say that. But of course we do say that, old boy. I thought I had no choice. I think I'm going to go back to having no choice. Yeah, I got to get up in the morning work. I got no choice. Got no choice. We got no choice. I got no choice. I got no choice. I got no choice. That's the mantra of the world. That's the underlying mantra of the world. I got no choice. I got no choice. I got no choice. I got no choice. They tell themselves that constantly. So when I ask them about it, they go, I got no choice. This is how they rationalize it all. The nightmare. Got no choice but to have this nightmare. That's just the programming of these stick figures. That's not spirit. Spirit knows it has a choice. Doesn't have to play the stupid game. So it's just the spirit's allowing those stick figures to speak for a spirit instead of spirit speaking for itself. So all you have to do is flip that script and say, have spirit start speaking for itself. Speak up. So I spoke up as spirit in the world, and people said, what are you talking about? We got no choice. Are you crazy? But they were speaking from the level of personality. Personality's program. Part of this virtual reality game, it's program. Personality is part of the programming. It tells you, you cannot believe anything a personality says. It's utter nonsense, actually. all thanks to Vajrayogini, the grace consort of Vajrasattva. All thanks to the Holy Spirit, is working wonders for us here. Miracles, what a miracle this has been here. People, you know, I want the water turned into wine. No, I'll take this any day. Flipping the whole script, showing the virtual reality gameness, possibility theory of all this, and, you know, just showing how we just say that we got no choice over it all. These are miracles of clarification. I'll take those any day over any sort of physical miracle. You know, okay, my injury's not healed right now, but my mind is getting healed, isn't it? I mean, my clarity is getting healed. I'll take that any day. I'll put up with the pain of the injury, but I'd much rather have this clarity clarified. This is fabulous. Fabulous miracle, actually. Miracles here, just tremendous miracles here. And we hit the two-hour mark, didn't we? Isn't that great? Yes, it is. So we're in rarefied atmosphere right now. This is like, you know, we're hanging out with spiritual aristocracy. I mean, royalty, spiritual royalty. I mean, these focus, putting our mind on this, the ability to put our mind on this is like, this is really rarefied, you know, at this. It is. It really is. But yeah, we say, oh, it's great. But of course, what do you expect? We expect this of ourselves. I said, of course we expect it of this ourselves. We're not speaking from the level of personality, so this is what we get. We never believed in personality. What is it? What a joke it is. It's an utter nonsense. That's what I always would say. This is just, I tell people, look, what you're talking about is total nonsense. What are you talking about? And in school, as that way, teachers say, what are you talking? This is just nothing but lies. It's just nothing but personality lies. And they didn't like that. You know, shut up. I don't know, what kind of student are you? I'm here to teach you the facts that science has told us. You know, I said, what? These are just liars. What are you talking about? And they'd kind of, they'd always look at me and say, well, you're so smart, but you really got a mouth on you. You know, you're really sassy. I mean, you know, you just say there's outrageous stuff. And they didn't like it. But they said, but you got so much potential. You're so smart. I got to figure out how to teach you the facts here. I'd say, what facts? These are just lies. And so, you know, that didn't go over well. I became sort of persona non grata. I could feel it. It was really terrible. It was just this feeling from the teachers that, like, you know, you're just, you know, there's something wrong with you. And we just, you know, we don't really like it. You're not really learning what you need to learn here. We're teaching you what's important. No, you got to know this stuff. This is really, I was like, no, it's not. And they said, we just don't really accept authority, our authority that we really, we're credentialed, for God's sakes. We're credentialed teachers, you know. This is what God wants you to know. This is what corporations want you to know. This is what politicians want you to know. This is what, you know, we want you to know. You got, this is what's important. You got to, and who are you to say that this isn't important? And I said, well, who are you to say that what you're telling me is important? Where are your credentials? What do you mean you got a piece of paper? What kind of credential is that? So I was just really, you know, stood up to authority, and the authority just hated it. I wasn't mean about it. I was very nice about it. So they weren't, you know, hostile to me in that way, like I was some troublemaker in that way. I mean, they put up with me, but they didn't like it. They accepted the fact that I was a gentleman, I was kind, it wasn't mean-spirited, and, you know, that everybody understood that. This is not some, you know, antisocial, mean-spirited person or anything, but you're also persona non grata because you're not accepting our authority of what's true. I said, well, what you're telling us is nothing but lies, so how can I respect your authority that what you're telling me is true? That's an absurdity. It's a total absurdity. It's just totally contrary to reason. This whole world is totally contrary to reason. All these so-called facts are contrary to reason, really, if you look at it. It's a ridiculous place. It's ridiculous. So ridiculous. So absurd. getting toward midnight. Well, I gotta get up in the morning, don't I? Hopefully I can. I got a new pillow today. Thank God. I hope it works. The other pillow I had was just a mess. It was just broken down in the middle. You know, one of these pillows where it loses its fluffiness and it's just all pushed out to the ends, and you keep trying to fluff it up in the middle. By the midway through the night, it's all pushed out towards the ends again. I mean, it is ridiculous. I paid good money for that pillow. It was supposed to be a really high quality one. It was just junk. It's just junk. So I got a Tempur-Pedic that's not going to do that. But the question is it going to be too, you know, hard for my head, or too firm for my head? You know, I don't know. It's supposed to be a soft Tempur-Pedic. Hopefully it works, because I haven't been able to sleep very well at all. I have a terribly bad neck from it, and you know. But I don't mind the hardships, because waking up at 4 every morning, it gives me all these hours to contemplate. I say, oh, I'm awake at 4. Great, let me start contemplating. But then, of course, you get tired during the daytime. So it's but hardship. You know, I've had nothing but hardship in my life, actually. Extreme hardship, but I embrace it. Here's opportunity. Here's motivation. Just use this motivation. Oh, I got a terrible job. Great. Let me use that as motivation to awaken to perfection. Oh, I'm so tired. Great. Let me use that as motivation to awaken to perfection. Oh, I'm so stressed out. Great. Yeah. Oh, I'm so this or that. Oh, great. Wonderful motivation. The worst thing possible would be to be wealthy. I realized this yesterday. I realized it many times. I realized, you know, if I had money, what would I do when I go home from work? What would I be doing? And I realized, well, you know, what I'd be doing? I'd probably be on vacation in the first place. Probably be retired. Probably be on vacation. Be on a cruise ship. You know, playing shuffleboard or gambling. Or just, you know, painting the town, gallivanting, or shopping, or just watching movies, eating restaurants, you name it. I'd be totally distracted. Just the way the wealthy are totally distracted. Except now I go home and I don't have a penny to do anything. What am I doing? I put up like 10 different videos on this Dharma King Longchenpa channel. 10 videos. I mean, I just absolutely crushed it, and plus tape for 3 hours, or what I was, 3.5 hours, or and did all this intense spiritual work, because that's all I can do. I don't have any money to do anything. I can't travel. I can't go on a cruise. I can't do any of this. I can't even go to a restaurant unless someone treats me. If I do anything, it's because someone treats me. That's it. So I got nothing else to do except all the spiritual work. That's all that's all I can afford. It's free. But I guarantee you, if I had money, are you kidding me? I'd probably be looking for a better, you know, I'd buy a house. I'd be looking for a better house. I'd be remodeling the house. I'd be landscaping. I'd be all the stuff that rich people do. I'd be doing the same thing, at least throughout my life. Now at this point, that wouldn't necessarily be true. I might just, you know, get a penthouse at some hotel and just hang out at the pool and just practice this, you know, practice this teaching. I wouldn't necessarily squander my time. It's up to the Holy Spirit. I don't know. Maybe He'll give me just enough to do what I need to do, and nothing more, not a penny more. That seems to be what my life has been like. Not a penny more. Just the bare minimum. And not a penny more. But that didn't stop me from getting into all sorts of debt and all this kind of stuff. Trying to do, you know, go through that whole thing and audit the whole system here. So I have an understanding of the suffering and misery everybody goes through. I've put myself through all this stuff. So I understand where they're coming from, because they kept saying that all these excuses. Well, you know, I got this problem, I got this problem, I got this problem. Yeah, but that doesn't prevent any of us from flipping the script. Sure, it prevents us from working to get more happiness in the world, but it doesn't prevent us from flipping the script and realizing this whole thing is completely fake. It doesn't prevent us from doing that. It doesn't matter where you are. You can flip this entire script, no matter what your job is, no matter who you are, with your destitute, whatever, you can realize this whole thing's completely fake, wherever you are. So your circumstances don't preclude that. And that's what you need to work on, is flipping the script. I mean, I have no idea how to get money. I really don't. I am like clueless. But I do know how to wake up from this dream entirely and say, I don't need this world at all. I could go to another place, actually, that's less reduced intensity. I can feel perfect right now. But I mean, as far as money goes, I'm about as ignorant as you could possibly be. I just don't understand how people get money. I just don't understand it. I think the Holy Spirit's blocked that understanding in me. I see them with vacation, all the stuff they do. I say, how is that even possible? How can they possibly have a lifestyle like that? I just don't get it. How can they get these jobs? I don't understand it. And the free time they have, and all the luck, it just boggles my mind. I don't even try to understand it. What are they doing that's so valuable? They get all this money. What? It's a mindset. It really is. If you don't have that mindset, it just the whole thing of money seems absolutely foreign to me. Totally alien. Like I said, if I have like $10, I think that's a lot of money. I say, wow, I'm rich. Got $10. Again, it's the greatest blessing there is. This is what I've discovered, that poverty is really the greatest blessing there is, the kind of poverty I have. I live in the maybe the best place in the world, but I'm also super poor. This is the best combination. Super blessing, super grace. The worst is to be wealthy. That's a curse, terrible curse to be wealthy in most cases, really bad. Now, you don't want to be, you know, destitute, but poor, just enough food, you know, bed to sleep in and some food, and you don't have anything, money for anything else, really. Maybe you get a shirt occasionally, or just a few little things, but really poor. This is a great help, great blessing. That's why Jesus emphasized this poverty. It's very important. Poverty, chastity, these things are super important, ultimately helpful, because that has enabled me to just totally focus on truth, and I don't have any money to do anything else. Do you see how beneficial it is? So it's the ultimate blessing. It really is. I've realized this. This is true. If you really want to succeed, poverty is almost an essential. Because as soon as you get that money, this world has millions of ways to get you to have to spend money in fun ways. There's never no end to it. Constantly advertising, you know, come here, do this, I mean, fun, fun, fun. There's almost infinite ways to have fun in this world. Right? Yeah, but if you don't have the money, all of those, you don't even think about it. I don't even think about it. It's not even on my mind at all these ways of, whereas if you have money, it's always on your mind. Like go to a baseball game. You have money, so am I going to the game tonight or not? Or maybe I go with my friends, I'm going to call them up. And all these plans, all the time you're making plans of how to spend your money. With me, I say, I don't have any money, so it doesn't even enter my mind. So I don't even go into making any plans whatsoever to do anything. So it completely frees my mind up to focus in on truth, because I'm not making any plans for anything, to do anything. The rich people are always making plans to do stuff. This is a fact. They never stop. They never stop. They're always planning. They got their calendar, you know, this and this and this, and we got to keep planning a trip, this and this and this. I got no calendar. I've never had a calendar. I never put anything on a calendar. What do I have to put on a calendar? I'm not doing anything. So I never have any plans for the future. Pretty much. So I just, in the back of my mind, is it'd be kind of nice, you know, if I could go to the desert and play some golf. And so that's just one thing that I use to keep some hope alive that maybe someday, you know, I'll have a vacation. But I don't really plan so much for it. I do a few things, like, you know, I've got some swim trunks. Maybe that'll help. I don't know. But other than that, no, my mind is not ever preoccupied with making plans for anything. And Jesus said, don't plan for the future. That's very important. He says it's one of the key elements of your success is don't make any plans. And I can certainly say I've lived a life in this way. I haven't made any plans, not even for my employment, and for nothing. I don't think about the tomorrow at all, the future at all, really. I don't even think about the next minute. My attention is fully on truth here. And, you know, it's a little scary. Sure it is, because everybody else has got all those plans. They got a calendar full of their life, and this is this, you know. And so it seems like really a risky thing to not plan, which is I have made no plans for the future at all. My future, I don't have any plans. Don't have any money, don't have any plans. It's like kind of scary. You start hitting 60, and you start like, Jesus, like, wow, you know, hello. I am getting a little bit older, at least it seems that way. So, you know, but I try not to think about it. I just say, you know, well, let the Holy Spirit deal with my future. I'll deal with right now. But I can understand how tough it is for people. It just, all of our society is all built on planning for the future, isn't it? So for someone like me, it does not plan at all. It just seems like you're a total loser. And the only way I could handle this was because my previous life, I was like a total winner. I was like one of society and culture's greatest winners. And historically seen as a great winner. And so I already felt I had this total approval of society and culture. So I felt like, hey, I don't need to, you know, get approval from society about what I do. So I just had this confidence that I don't need that. I've already got it. I've already experienced that. And it really wasn't any fun, actually, at all, to tell you the truth. Like I said, I was super famous, super, you know, a cultural icon. And it was hell. I didn't like it. It really was hell. I felt very, very, I needed, this is something I want to escape. And you find out that famous people, this is how they feel. They it's like, wow, I want to go to some dude ranch in Montana or something. Let me just get away from this. But so this life, I felt like I can just not plan at all. And doesn't matter what people think of me. I don't care. It's the approval of people is very overrated. Very much so. Having everyone think you're so great is very overrated. So that, that I think, enabled me to just not plan at all for the future. As I've already been extremely successful here, and you know, what did it do? What did it get me? A return ticket. It got me a return ticket to this world. So What value did that have? Right? I said, that's no value at all. And since Jesus says, don't plan for the future, this is how you'll succeed, I trust him, I believe him. So I said, let's try that. What's the worst that can happen? I get a return ticket to the world. You know, if I don't plan for the future, what's the worst that could happen? Come back here again. And since I already know that planning, succeeding didn't work, I might as well try this. What I got to lose? If I become destitute and starve to death, I starve to death. You know, whatever. I mean, well, that, you know, well, if I come back here, I come back here. I'll try something different if that happens. But I have this confidence that I won't be coming back here, actually. And this, what I've done this lifetime is what works. That's not to say that I'm not a little bit nervous about the future, because the circumstances are such that I'm soon going to be facing destitution, you know? Could be, absolutely. And so, but that's, so this pushes me. I say, great, that's great motivation. Thank you. The fear of destitution is a great motivator. It really is. I mean, lights a fire under me. Could have no place to stay, no money, no nothing. No capacity to function in society at all. You need money to function in society. You need network. I have no friends, no network, no nothing. So this pushes me to just like work. Like now, it's like midnight. It's past midnight, and this video is like already two hours and 20 minutes. And I'm like full blast here. You know, full blast. Like, and it's coming on a day of full blast of practice all day. Guru power Longchenpa, guru power Longchenpa, guru power Longchenpa, guru power Longchenpa, guru permission Longchenpa, guru permission Longchenpa, guru power. I'm all day saying this out loud, you know, I'm driving. I don't care what people think, there's some guy saying something. Guru power Longchenpa. Right now, guru power right now, guru power right now, guru power right now. See, I'm spending all day doing this and then hitting this taping like this because I got this, you know, fear of God. That was the gift of the Holy Spirit in the church. They gave us all these little fortune cookie paper things. You open them up, and my gift was the fear of God. Well, this is what it was kind of getting at. That you use this fear of destitution to drive yourself. This is a grace of God, actually. Fear of poverty, fear of destitution. This is a grace that we're given. It's a great grace because it really pushes you. You can't let up. You can't let up. If I had money, I'd let up. Who wouldn't? Who wouldn't? I'd say, oh, there's this place I've always wanted to go. I've always wanted to see Alaska or something. Oh, there's a cruise? Really? How much is it? Oh, I can afford that. You want to go? Oh, yeah. Hey, that'd be a lot of fun. You know, let's get the camera and take pictures, and we'll go. I need to go shopping. I need clothes. I need to get clothes. Oh, I need to do this. I need to do that. I need to get my wardrobe together, my suitcase together, and do some taping up there. You know, and I need to talk to people. I need to study it. You know, where am I going? What do I expect to go? And before you know it, you spent months and months and months of your life preparing for this trip. And then you go on the trip, and you come back, and you're showing people pictures, slide. You know, they don't do slideshows anymore. But you're showing video shows of your trip. You're talking to people about it. You're planning your next one. You got more ideas of where you can go. And before you know it, your life is over. It's just like that. It's just like that. And whereas for me, I got this fear of destitution that says I better be enlightened right now. I better be free of this ridiculous virtual reality game right now. Today. Guru power Longchenpa today. And I'm just hitting them with this empowerment all day long. So the fear of God indeed, quote unquote, if you take it in the right way, that's a gift of the Holy Spirit that I have. Very, very potent, effective one. But, you know, it's kind of like, wow, I get up in the morning and say, hey, can I take it easy today, God? And he says, well, you got the means to take it easy? I say, no. He says, well, I guess you can't take it easy today. And I say, ah, wow, I've got to do it again. I'll do myself again today. Holy cow, this is just, how do I do that? Guru power, Longchenpa. I need miracles, Longchenpa. Miracles, Jesus Christ. Miracles, Jesus Christ. Miracles, Vajrayogini. Miracles, Vajrayogini. Miracles, Ravana Maharshi. Come on. I need miracles. Come on. Dharma King miracles. Dharma King miracles. Dharma King miracles. Dharma King miracles. So I'm literally saying this intensely, you know, for hours. Because I need the miracles. That's my riches. I need the miracles. And I need them right now, today. So this is how it works. Yeah. So look at your situation and the pressures you're under. Realize there are grace of God that are driving you. So wow, I really need to succeed on this path. I'm not a dilettante. I need success here. I need to be super successful at this. Got to keep the hangman from the door, you know, from my door. The hounds of destitution are, you know, scratching and sniffing at my door and baying at my door. But I have to fend them off somehow. It's middle class people that can be hit with destitution, actually. Poor people, they're criminals, basically. They know how to survive. Really, they have no conscience about doing whatever they need to do to survive. This is a fact. And it's not judging them, I understand. They're good people, nice people, but if they need to do something, they'll do it. And for me, we have all these middle class scruples. I could never be like that. They'll lie. They will absolutely lie. They'll tell any lie they need to tell. They say, well, just do this. They tell me, just do this. I say, what? I mean, you're totally lying and taking advantage and cheating. They say, well, I got to eat. You know, what can I say? I say, well, I can't do that. I can't lie to people. I came here to tell people the truth. I can't deceive people. I mean, I can't do those things. So, you know, poor people don't have the same fear of destitution that a middle-class person does. Not at all. I talk to them. I talk to people. I got nothing. They shrug and say, well, I'll get some. I'll find a way. If I have to steal, I'll steal. If I have to get some out, one way or another, I'm going to survive. They're survivalists. They're not really bothered by it. Their minds, I think, why aren't you mind? Why aren't you like freaked out? They're not freaked out at all. They shrug their shoulders and say, well, I've got no choice. Maybe I gotta do what I gotta do. They're not bad people. I mean, if they have to break into your house and steal stuff, they will. They will. It doesn't make them bad people. They just they say, I gotta survive. And if they got to misrepresent themselves, they got to cheat on welfare, if they got to get government assistance by lying and deceiving, they'll do exactly that. And they do. I mean, the corruption is just unbelievable. I'm aware of so much corruption among poor people, among immigrants. People come here, whatever, they don't have a lot, you know. Oh, they're so corrupt. Their friends, you know, get them this, get them that, do this, that, you know, you know, fake this, fake that. So corrupt, so unbelievable, and it doesn't bother them at all. Some of them it bothers a little bit. They have a conscience. But a lot of them, sure, they say, what can I do? I got to survive. So they don't feel they're a bad person because they're criminal and corrupt and doing all this illegal stuff. They don't. It doesn't bother them. But for me, I'd rather be dead than do this. You know, it's unthinkable. It's disgraceful. Yeah, I've been brought up to be very much to be graceful, genteel, aristocratic, graceful. You know, I'm a moral aristocrat. I was brought up in a very aristocratic way. You know, noblesse oblige, and you don't do that stuff. This is utterly disgraceful. It's like a samurai. You have a code. You have a code of ethics, and the samurai, you know, was faced with a situation where they had to break the code of ethics. They'd commit suicide rather than do that. So I'm very much like a samurai, you know, in this way. You know, you got your pride, you have your dignity. You don't stoop. You don't stoop low. You know, if you do slum, it's intentional to audit the situation. Okay, but as far as, you know, how you treat people and how you deal with situations, you just don't stoop down that way at all. So this is, you know, this is the middle class of the noble middle class, the true genteel people, that they you know, this is the way. So they, you know, I cannot even think in that way. You know, it's disgraceful, absolutely disgraceful. So this is why I have a, you know, fear of destitution for sure. And even begging, I can't beg. I can't beg. It's just an abhorrence to me. I feel like I would shatter my psyche, you know, to ask for anything. If I'm stuck somewhere, it's my tough luck. I don't put my hand out and beg. The very idea just freaks me out. You know, if you don't have stuff, that's your tough luck. You don't go to a soup kitchen and get free food or do this stuff. You starve to death. So this is my mindset, and so you know, it's like, oh, that scares me. I'm not a survivalist at all. I'm not a survivalist. I'm the farthest thing from a survivalist imaginable. I just shrug my shoulders and say, well, that, you know, that's the way it goes. Hopefully, I don't come back here. I might have to rely on the benefactors of poor people to keep me alive, who are willing to do all that stuff. And I might take their food, you know, but for me to do it, it's like, no way. That I've got some, you know, some dignity. I'll do, you know, terrible. They're dirty jobs and stuff, but I'll do it in an honest way. You know, I won't take advantage. I'll do it in an honest way as much as I can. I mean, as much as possible. You know, you got to. So anyway, it's interesting, isn't it? The mindsets of different people. A lot of times these poor people become very rich. It's usually the poor people who become rich. The middle class generally doesn't become rich. They're too honest. But the poor people, a lot of the real powerful wealthy people start out dirt poor because they'll do anything. No scruples. Whatever it takes to just survive. And so they'll do all sorts of stuff to gain advantages. Yeah, this is true. This is true. Middle class pretty much stay middle class, or they slip down lower. But only the ones who start cheating a lot and taking advantage a lot go up, you know, become wealthy. This is true. I like middle class people. I'm a middle classer. They're honest. They're really honest. They're straightforward. They're honest. They don't take advantage of you. You can trust them. I don't even worry about middle class people. Just trust them. They're trustworthy. And when they do something that's not trustworthy, it's a scandal. I mean, it's just shocking to me. I had someone sell me a car that was a piece of junk, but they had a dead battery. They charged it up and sold the car to me. Got home the next morning, the battery's completely dead. And I was just shocked at this, that someone would, a middle class person, a neighbor, would do this. I mean, this is just unthinkable. You just don't do that. You don't sell somebody something that's a piece of junk and you know it is. You just don't do it. If it's a junk, you eat it. You know, that's your problem. You don't deceive somebody else and